delighted to continue our Mason Institute lunch series with Professor John Harrington, who's going to speak to us about his recent research in global health law and security. John is Professor of Global Health Law and Director of the Center for Law and Global Justice at Cardiff University. He has held fellowships at the European University Institute, the Universities of Dar es Salaam, Cape Town, and Melbourne, and at the British Institute for Eastern Africa in Eastern Africa. He was previously Professor of Law at the University of Liverpool and Director of its Institute of Medicine, Law and Bioethics, as well as holding lectureships at the University of Warwick and the Free University of Berlin. He has published widely on medical law, legal theory, global health law, and legal education in Africa. Publications include Global Health and Human Rights, Legal and Philosophical Perspectives from 2010, Global Governance of HIV/AIDS, Intellectual Property and Access to Essential Medicines from 2013, and most recently this past year, Towards the Rhetoric of Medical Law, runner-up for the SLSA Legal Theory Book Prize. And I own a copy and I highly recommend it. That was a free plug. His current project draws on extensive fieldwork in Kenya to examine the role played by national values and institutions in the implementation and transformation of global health law. Let's welcome Professor John Harrington. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Edward, and thanks to Neha as well for arranging this seminar, and to Graham, who can't make it, I guess, for the invitation. It's really flattering to come and speak to the Mason Institute, which is so prominent in British and international health law studies. It's a real honour. Edward has mentioned what I'm on at the moment, which builds on a period of about 4 years spent in Kenya at the British Institute there. And as the introduction said, I'm interested in global health law, but I'm interested in how it's being perceived, implemented, and refracted at national level, and what effect that has on it. So in the paper today, I look at, briefly, a recent text, the key text, I guess, in global health law by Larry Gostin from about 3 years ago, and pick out some points that could be built on in that, I suppose, or remedied to a certain extent. And then I try and do that by looking at one case study and making two theoretical moves. So the case study I'm looking at has to do with infectious disease control, but particularly biosecurity and the weaponization of infectious diseases, pathogens, and the steps taken by the United States to prevent that, I suppose, through governance measures. That's the case study. It's the visit of a leading US senator to Kenya while I was there in 2010. So I pick apart that. That's the latter half of the paper. The two theoretical moves are to look at a model of global health or global health governance based on nodal governance theories developed by Drahos and colleagues. And I'll say a bit about that. Presume no prior knowledge of any discipline, and I'm happy to stop and clarify. Please do that at any point, and also on the questions afterwards. So I set that up as global health law as nodal governance, and I explain that a bit. And within nodal governance, I make my second theoretical move, which is to highlight the element of rhetoric, which is what I was writing on in the British case. Persuasion, speech, discourse. And to say that that's a neglected element of global health, or that that's a productive way of seeing global health law as it's developing in its contexts which are neglected. So I pull those two together and I run them through, I suppose, the case study, the senator's visit to East Africa in 2010, and see how he's speaking about biosecurity, what rhetoric he's using, who he's persuading and how, what the resonances of this are. Obviously, rhetoric here, I don't mean lies or spin, I mean strategic speech. Good or bad isn't the primary issue here. So that's the structure really of the paper, I suppose. So, so global health law has really emerged over the last 15 years as an area of practice, generation of norms. And it came of age academically. It's been a lot of writing, but it came of age with its first textbook in 2014 by Larry Gulston, who's had several careers as a medical lawyer behind him. He's justly renowned. He's now at Georgetown. And so in terms of substance, he's looking at tobacco control, infectious disease control, access to essential medicines and intellectual property, the kind of things people like myself and others teach when we teach global health law. What is the law on this? I'm interested in how he frames his textbook. And these are points, I suppose, that I pick up on and might critique a little. It's certainly cast in a universalist, from a universalist point of view. On the one hand, humanity faces health challenges, non-communicable diseases, the AIDS pandemic, the tobacco industry. And in a way, humanity is faced by globalization, ontologized as thing which changes the world, which poses the challenge now to which the lawyers have to respond and the academics. In terms of the model of law, and he admits that this is a limitation, but he's got to be getting on and doing his textbook, and I understand that. There's an element of diffusionism. Global health law emanates out from Washington and Geneva, WHO. It emanates out from the global centers. That's where the norms are made and struggled over and implemented on the global periphery. I'm simplifying. There is more nuance in this book, and I certainly don't want to damn this. But there is that diffusionist element, which has a long tradition in writing about public health, going back to the imperial period. So on this model, he sees global health law as a subset of public international law in the first instance. So treaties are either there or should be aspired to. He notes, of course, soft law. The UNICEF code on the marketing of formula milk, for example, is exemplary in this regard, but in essence, it's a type of public international law. My issues with this are, as I've suggested in my own introduction here, he neglects the national. The national here, which is on the global periphery, so it's on the global south. Global health law and governance is done in and to the global south. This model tends to neglect the national and subnational institutions of the global south as authentic players in the game of creating global health law. Their courts, for example, in relation to access to medicines and patents and the right to health, we can see, don't simply receive. And my work in Kenya and other areas, things like traditional medicine, the UNICEF code, WHO UNICEF code on formula, sees the national parliament particularly as articulating national interests in the reception, transformation of global health norms and resistance to them. This also neglects the South-South dimension, so an Indian precedent on the Novartis case, if you know it, can patents be extended indefinitely through Evergreen, gets picked up in Kenya. Activists move. They move to Geneva, but they also move to Bangalore. So these are some of the ways in which I think Gulston's interesting and excellent text needs to be augmented. The model I've suggested for doing this is called nodal governance. This is Peter Drappos. I was looking for a nice image, but I end up with the white male professor. I will have to change the image somehow. For a more figurative representation of that. I've got one coming. Actually, let me go to it. So the kind of mind map of nodal governance is nodes. I'll explain what's in the text here. But nodes and our governance nodes enroll each other towards particular governance outcomes. The Kenya Association of Manufacturers enrolls the Trade Committee of the Kenya Parliament in order to limit the scope of a bill implementing the UNICEF code on formula milk. Médecins Sans Frontières tries to do differently. Now the interesting thing, the useful thing I think about nodal governance is that these governance nodes, this is a flat topology, this isn't hierarchical. Nodes enroll each other. Colin Scott's well-known paper says the private can govern the public, private standards, the accountancy bodies, for example, can govern the actions of states in the global south and not just the credit rating. I'm struggling for the phrase here. The quality of states' bonds, for example, are ranked by rating agencies, Dun & Bradstreet, Fitch. These ratings of a country's creditworthiness, which then allow them to borrow or not in the international market. So there's that element, private nodes govern public nodes. And then, so they act by enrollment. They enroll each other towards a particular outcome, each node. So a node can include a manufacturer's association, pharmaceutical manufacturers at national and international level. It includes the traditional state nodes, Parliament, Ministry of Health. So the state isn't one thing, but an assembly, a network of nodes. And they are continually, this is a kind of emergent system, enrolling each other towards particular governance outcomes and to securing those outcomes. So Dreyfus has written about the TRIPS agreement. Do you know the TRIPS agreement? Precisely in this nodal governance term of the Pfizer enrolling the other pharmaceutical manufacturers, enrolling the US Trade Representative, putting pressure on other countries' governance, and the accumulation of that leading to the TRIPS agreement, and so on. The game goes on. Each node has three or four properties. Three I'm picking out here are resources, technologies, and mentalities. Resources can be money, but it can also be legal power. A court can issue injunctions. A court can find legislation unconstitutional. That's a resource or a technology, indeed, a mechanism. A state has military power. These are technologies for achieving things. The last one is the one I'm emphasizing here, which is mentalities. The mentality of the International Monetary Fund is different, obviously, from that of the World Health Organization. And it uses these mentalities rhetorically, communicatively, to persuade other nodes. To persuade, for example, the trade ministry in the interest of national development. There is mentalities are really how problems are seen. Are they seen in terms of health? Is intellectual property seen in terms of health? Is it seen in terms of trade? A kind of framing is what we might consider as mentality. These are the elements of nodes which they use to enroll each other. This model I find useful, particularly for states in the global south, because the state in the global south, increasingly in the global north, is transnationalized. Different bits of the state are often more strongly connected to international bodies than they are to the rest of the state. The health ministry, I go back to formula milk, maybe working quite closely with UNICEF or the World Health Organization on this, getting the policy inputs, getting resources like funding to support programs which are not coming out of central government funds. So the state is what I might call differentially transnationalized. The central bank, the analogy here, the comparator is finance. The central bank will be quite closely connected with the International Monetary Fund because it's dependent on loans. So that the mentality of the International Monetary Fund, Chicago economics, to put it stereotypically, plays out in the central bank. You want a central bank who does that. I've mentioned about rhetoric and cultural ready, I suppose. That's an important element of nodal governance. It's strategic. Strategic speech is rhetoric. So my case study, as an instance of nodal governance, is the visit of Senator Richard Lugar in 2010 to the Kenya Medical Research Institute and its equivalent in Uganda in November of that year. And that's Senator Lugar with Samuel Mpokoe, the director of the Kenya Medical Research Institute. And as I've suggested, Lugar's concern, the concern of the United States at this time, was with the weaponization of pathogens and the threat to the US homeland presented by this. So he took a very high-level team of staff from the Cooperative Threat Reduction Program of the Department of Defense. Now, the background to this is presented by the anthrax attack of 2001 after the 9/11 atrocities, when anthrax was sent in the post to US officials, causing a scare. Also, dissatisfaction with the Biological and Toxin Weapons Convention of 1972, which placed obligations on states not to develop biological weapons, to stop their proliferation and to assist each other. And UN Security Council Resolution 1540 of 2004, which really reiterated that. The problem with these, from the American point of view, was they were addressed to states only. And we're talking here about non-state terrorists, basically, non-state actors. And there were no enforcement mechanisms. So the multilateral, if we go back to the hierarchical model, the multilateral system wasn't working from the American point of view. There was a fear that the terrorist groups would be able to weaponize things like anthrax and Ebola. The World Health Organization had issued more detailed biosafety and biosecurity guidelines in this period, in the 2000s, but again, there was no enforcement. And so what Lugar is trying to do, really, is to get aid directed to laboratories in East Africa and more widely to promote biosecurity, aid paid for by the United States. So the last point I need to mention is that the focus of the trip is the laboratory. Kenya Medical Research Institute is a parastatal body, very well established, many collaborations, the Wellcome Trust, Centers for Disease Control. It's really the hub of medical research in Kenya and a key partner across HIV research and many other fields. So it's an important body. And its laboratories were the focus of the test. So the center comes to the laboratories and the funding would flow back. So I'll give you this picture again. I've mapped this out. Governance notes. Senator Lugar, I suppose, in his office. Senator Lugar was the leading foreign affairs senator at the time in the United States. He was since overthrown by the Tea Party. So God knows what's followed him. I'm doing a left critique of Lugar, and perhaps I should follow up. But so Lugar is really trying to enroll the US Congress, trying to persuade the US Congress to direct funding, to use some of its resources towards KEMRI so that they can improve security in their laboratories. Now, the interesting thing, the kind of so-called post-Westphalian aspect of this is that we've got governance happening from one national body. It's cross-border governance from one national body to another, not going through a multilateral treaty, not going through the Kenyan Parliament, for example, or the Health Ministry, or the Security Ministry, or the Kenyan military, the US military. And it's been done by the supply of resources that's necessary. So it's kind of development aid. And with most development aid, I think again in the case of the IMF, conditions are applied. It's conditional development aid. And the conditions are brought in here. They're leveraged. These are conditions from the World Health Organization about biosafety and biosecurity. So there is a multilateral element, but it's not normative. It's simply out there and leveraged it. So really what the rest of my paper is looking at is this bit, is how Lugar is going to persuade the US Congress to disperse. In fact, to continue to disperse, because there are long-standing relations between the U.S. military and the Kenyan military and the U.S. military. And KEMRI, Centers for Disease Control, is a quasi-military, has its origins in military, in the U.S. military, and still does. So it's really the question, I suppose the salient point for global health law and global health governance is that what's happening on this axis within the United States, admittedly, it's staged in Kenya and East Africa, it plays out there rhetorically, but what's happening on this axis determines health governance within Kenya, determines the kind of criteria applied for lab safety, biosecurity, and so on. In a third, in another country, in Kenya, in this case. So that it's important for us to, if we're mapping health governance in Kenya, understood as nodal governance, and having this rhetorical component, it's important for us to think about what's persuasive in the United States, nationally. Okay. The second theoretical move that I want to make is, and it's in the title of my paper, is about the quality of the rhetoric that he's using. The way I analyze his rhetoric is with reference to this idea of space and time together, or the chronotope. This is from literary theory. You've got to hold on here. Hold on tightly. Chronotope. So if it's rhetoric, it's a cultural product. So we analyze it in terms of its likely effectiveness and its content, we are warranted in analyzing it by using tools of cultural analysis. And the one I think is useful here is the chronotope. The chronotope comes from the Russian theorist Mikhail Bakhtin. The chronotope is a kind of time-space entity together. Examples are better than theories. The road movie is a chronotope. Anyone seen Easy Rider? Around America? So you move. Homer's Odyssey for the better educated.
No.
That should capture everything. High or low culture. You move through space in time. And that's essential to the plot because the character develops. So that chronotope of the road movie, of the quest, for example, is essential. Time and space are combined. You kind of one without the other, is what this is arguing. Another form is the pastoral, the village, Goldsmith's deserted village, for example, Beethoven's Sixth Symphony. I'm trying to think of a kind of pop pastoral, I'm not sure. Okay, the idea of England as a garden.
Whiskey galore.
Huh?
Whiskey galore.
Thank you. Okay. So a village, time, stuck in time. So it may be the African village. We see this with Kenyan legislators talking about traditional medicine. I remember my village. I'm in Nairobi now. I've got an apartment, blah, blah, blah. But I come from a village. And in that village, we have breastfeeding mothers and traditional healers that are revered by the community. And this is all under threat from outside. You see how this argument can go to pass a law defending Kenyan traditional medicine. My point here is that rhetorically, the chronotope of the village is important to that. And it's time and space. It's out, up country, wherever, in the provinces. And it's back a bit in time, and it stayed still in time. Yeah. I won't say any more about that, but we've got the handle on chronotopes, and we'll find them everywhere. That's, I suppose, one argument. They're kind of generic. They're different. They're multiple. Asiatic cholera, let me give you that one, I suppose, from International Health. In the 19th century, labeling disease as Asiatic cholera, the 1831 epidemic, and the other two in the 19th, major ones in the 19th century, were seen as spreading from India across through Russia and into Western Europe. The chronotope here is an origin in the East. There's an element of threat, but there's also the element of its coming gradually, or not gradually, perhaps, rapidly. It It's in Königsberg last week, Danzig the next week, Berlin. It's the idea of spreading, which is big, I suppose, in public health and global health. The tobacco epidemic, so-called. Time and space knitted together. My source for that's the sociolegal theorist Mariana Valverde. It's a nice book and worth looking up. So at last we get to the senator and his tour. And really what I'm going to do here is look at the senator's output, the reports, the newspaper reports, his speeches, with a bias towards the American sources. So this is very, you know, Euro-Northern-centric, deliberately so. I've set that out in my model. If we want to know some of what's happening in terms of health governance in Kenya, then we have to attend to the parochial stuff that's happening in Washington. We have to accept, Chakrabarty says, provincialize Europe. Don't take it as necessarily universal, but we do have to pay attention to it. So what type of arguments is he making? And I suppose I break this up to persuade the US Congress. To persuade the US Congress, as I say, to deliver the resources to support this. Just forgive me, but I log back on here. So what are the chronotopes that help us to make sense of his visit and its persuasiveness? Well, the first chronotope, I think, is the inspection tour. He gets a movement through time and space, a bit like the quest, but of a particular form. It's a particular form of global governance generally, not just in health, where the representative of the north or the center comes out and visits facilities on the periphery. So it produces this center-periphery model. He's reporting back. His report that I studied, pulled off the web and studied, is a report back to, in fact, the rhetorical mode of address is back to his constituents in Indiana. So some of the pages are, you know, people in Indiana will find this very interesting, but most of the rest of it is addressed to a wider American public, and it's inspecting what's out there. I think there are parallels here with IMF inspections, International Monetary Fund inspections, again in the 80s and 90s, the period of structural adjustment, when, or indeed in Greece and Ireland more recently, when the Troika would fly into Dublin or Athens and ask to see the books. What are you doing? What are you cutting? And then fly out. Another parallel is the Election Observer. So the current cycle of election, the cycle of elections means that the elections again in Kenya this year, presidential elections, there's always a mass of observers. The European Union is only one, the Carter Center, so we're looking at non-state as well as state bodies, watching the conduct of the election and reporting back on its fairness. And I suppose there is a longer standing tradition of travel and inspection in Africa, since I'm in Scotland. This is the map of David Livingstone's journeys through Africa, 1853 to 1871, I think. Okay, it's a journey of discovery, but it's also reporting back, equally Stanley and so on. We see it fictionalized in Joseph Conrad. Humanitarian inspections, Roger Casement. There is a tradition here, a chronotope. And I'm keen on the resonance of contemporary chronotopes with the past that adds to their persuasiveness. I hate to talk about Brexit, but if we talk about, the island under threat from the Spanish Armada, this is so commonplace, it's banal and annoying. The Spanish Armada or Napoleon or Juncker or whatever, these are the resonances over time that have some purchase. Okay, the next chronotope, I think, and we find this, I'm backing this up in my text with quotes, is this shrinking globe. Contagion, anyone seen Contagion? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a nice little journey into the American or the Western psyche about these things. That phrase up there you find everywhere. You find everywhere in writing about infectious diseases globally. You find it in Gosden's book. You want to start an article on this, whack it in. Infectious diseases do not recognize the boundaries set by national borders. Germs don't carry passports. So what we've got is the articulation of globalization. The germ is the kind of new cosmopolitan, the bad new cosmopolitan citizen, smashing borders. Lugar mentions a tourist, Dutch tourist, infected with Marburg fever in a Uganda national park. So this is a slightly different mobility, but the tourist expects to travel where she or he wants to, but there is risk.
An inflection on the same thing.
You know, Marxist geographers like David Harvey talk about time-space compression as a function of capitalism. We've got a Marxist view of globalization then. What is it Marx says? Space is abolished by time.
And this is happening. This is happening with the disease. As contagion suggests,
as Lugar suggests, this is a cause of anxiety.
It can be read in another way.
The legal scholar, Obi Aghanom,
adopts this approach,
but spends it normatively and says, well, actually, with this compression, we're getting, it's a kind of utopian view, we're getting a new world community, and we're all responsible for each other within this. A kind of what he calls the ethics of mutual vulnerability. So slightly different from Lugar's approach, where the priority was clearly defending the homeland.
But both share
this time-space compression.
Okay,
the next chronotope is the laboratory itself. So he visits the laboratories. He's pictured visiting the laboratories. He takes pictures like this. Are any of you medical scientists working in laboratories?
No. Too many lawyers. In the
Too many lawyers. I can say what I'm
Or by rather, sorry.
I get away with anything here. So here's a freezer with samples. Near Entebbe in Uganda, which is the other place, the Ugandan equivalent of Kenya,
that he visits, and the caption is, you know, and there's worse than this, as it were. There's samples lying on the floor, boxes lying on the floor, and things on store,
lists written out in biro, scientists taking photographs of samples or findings with their phones in order to disseminate them. Clearly, a lack of resources, an inability to do standard science, and the medical anthropologists have written a lot about this, the aspiration in the global south, coming from the period of independence in the 1960s, to build a national science base, to participate in global or international science, and the failure to do so because of the collapse of the state, or structural adjustment, or whatever else. And he's clearly not referencing that, but he may be finding some of the consequences of it.
So he talks about, echoing Lenin, I suppose, although unconsciously, I have no doubt,
that the laboratories are weak links in the chain of infectious disease surveillance. So the laboratory would ideally be, in terms of time and space, participating in an even universal science. And it would be capable thereby of delivering real-time information, for example, temporal again, about disease outbreaks. That's the ideal, the aspiration.
He finds a situation which is different from this. They can't participate as members of the vigilant community of science because of this. Okay.
The swamp.
So the map says it all. There's Africa.
Africa is not a country, but it usually is in these discourses.
Ebola, so it's much later, outbreak. But the quotes here are from Lugar's visit. Wet and on the equator, a natural petri dish for some of the most deadly diseases on the planet.
this is really the discourse of tropicality, and it's the kind of, it's a negative version of the pastoral. It's an unchanging reservoir. This is how Hegel thought of Africa. It's kind of out of history, before history. And it generates infections, infectious diseases. So spatially defined as the continent, Africa is the marker for this, and temporally stuck beyond history. I'm simplifying and shortening. But that, I think, is the resonance of that. That is the cause of anxiety. Cynthia Pahuja, who's a late international law scholar, critical international law scholar, talks about the fear. Again, she's talking more about finance, economic governance, but the fear of a reversion of African states or states in the global south to what she calls primordialism, to backwards, a falling out of history, and a need to discipline those states. And we'll see this in a second. Okay, I said he visited the laboratories. There he is, in Nairobi, in the Camry Labs. In Nairobi, and he's standing at the fence on the edge of the laboratory, so that's all there is, a 4-foot-high wall and a bit of barbed wire. And the anthrax and other samples are within the laboratory on one side of it, not massively well, you know, as well accounted for as could be expected of the staff, given the circumstances they're working under. I need to put it like that. But on the other side of a wall here, is Kibera, which is known as the largest slum in Africa. The Constant Gardener, you've seen that one? That was filmed in Kibera, you know, the glistening tops of the shacks. It's a popular destination for slum tourists who come to Nairobi. They like to visit Kibera. There's nearly a million people in there. Kibera was the site in 2007, so before, but not long before Lugar's visit, of considerable violence between the residents and the state, which followed a disputed presidential election in Kenya. The violence spread and became so intense, over 1,000 people were killed, and the state nearly collapsed. And it ended up in the International Criminal Court.
And this is all ongoing while the visit is here. So the report talks about barely policed square mile of tin roof shacks where terrorist groups seek to recruit. Again, it's
the theme of primordialism, I suppose, the theme of ongoing. If the laboratory is ungoverned or insufficiently governed within, and the adjoining space is also, and even more so, ungoverned and presenting a threat. And I found a picture, not massively systematic research here, but I found a nice picture, which I think compares and contrasts, as they say. Now, this is Robert Kennedy at the Berlin Wall in 1961. And he's looking, so here's another senator. I was on an inspection tour at the edge of the empire. And he's looking over the wall at East Germany, at the German Democratic Republic. But I think we, in a way, we can simplistically contrast. Here's Westphalia, and here's post-Westphalia. Here, the space beyond is fluid, threatening, unpoliced, unaccounted for, mobile, changing in some ways. Whereas Kennedy is looking in at a space that's almost dead, because the state is so powerful, it's locked everything down, no one can move. Everyone is registered. We know this now with the fall of the wall in the GDR, but it was pretty well known even at the time. Okay. The last chronotope, which we find in the reports, is the chronotope of porous borders. Kenya itself as chronotope. Kenya has, of course, got territorial ridge, so spatial, but also temporal, in the sense that, in the sense of vulnerability. So we look at the neighborhood here. This map is from the report itself. We look at the region that Kenya's in. It's
abutted by unstable states, close to countries of burgeoning populations and a lack of infrastructure, essentially failed or failing states. And Somalia's, of course, is the ultimate bad boy in failed states. It's the go-to. And Kenya shares a very long border with Somalia. The Somali minority inside Kenya, terrorists have, and since the report, penetrated down along the coast. They attacked a shopping mall in Nairobi, killing about 50 people. The Al-Shabaab group, which is a wing, I suppose, of Al-Qaeda. So I'm not saying that Lugar is factually incorrect, but I'm interested in the presentation. Is of Kenya itself as a vulnerable state. The laboratory is vulnerable because it's next to the slum, and Kenya is vulnerable because its borders are porous. They can be permeated in time with groups crossing in. The kind of groups who would come in notionally, according to Lugar, steal the pathogens, weaponize them, and direct them at the United States. And he has to make this case as strongly as possible. I suppose my simpler argument is that this array of chronotopes is his way of doing, is how he's doing that. And by looking at these chronotopes, we get a sense of the history, the resonances, the context that allows us to do. Yeah, Susan Rice, US representative in Africa under Bush, and then representative to the United Nations under Obama, talks about Africa as the world's soft underbelly for terrorism. Okay, two groups of conclusions. We're coming to an end. I think I've gone over everything already. Nice. Chronotopes. There's no one chronotope. There's no kind of master narrative. You know, the West and the South or whatever. There's a few, and they're different, and they're articulated together. The art of it is to pull them together in a way, however unconsciously. To pull them together and make a persuasive case out of them. I've talked about historical and cultural resonances. I've alluded to them at least. I'm arguing that the national matters. This is American culture. Now, American culture, of course, goes global, but it starts as American. Valverde, whose book I mentioned way back on chronotopes, said that each chronotope comes with a particular mood. So the pastoral is nostalgia, is regret. The whole of humanity faces this threat now chronotope is anxiety, readiness for action. If we talk about, if we look at an epidemic, an infectious disease situation, we can look at it in terms of that threat, immediacy, the whole world together, that sort of chronotope with its mood of anxiety. If we look at infectious disease in terms of evidence-based medicine, if we look at public health in terms of evidence and evidence basis, then we've got a more longer-term, optimistic, faith in progress, mood evoked by looking at the problem within those particular terms. And we've got a combination of moods here. We've got fear, we've got faith in progress, we've got fatalism, the swamp idea, I think, is a matter of fatalism. I'll leave the last one there. This is my last slide. The potential for chronotopical analysis in global health law. I don't want to wait around, this kind of combined time-space form, structuring arguments. The right to health. You're familiar with the right to health? The idea of progressive realization? So we have civil and political rights, like the right to life. They must be realized immediately. A state is no difference is accepted as between Burundi and Belgium when it comes to the right to life, the right to a fair trial. Whereas if we talk about social rights, like the right to health, the UN treaty governing that says states are required to implement the right progressively, having regard to their own means.
So what is expected of Belgium is not expected of Burundi. They take steps. Chronotopes here, with civil and political rights, we get one world and one set of rights. In a way, it's kind of timeless. It should be done. With social and economic rights, the world is fragmented into states, and each follows its own trajectory. Now, there are qualifications on that. I can go into it. There are qualifications, except that for now. But in essence, we have two different chronotopes, which allow us to distinguish between civil and political rights and economic and social rights.
Health, legal access to medicine, health chronotopes.
I've mentioned, really, the Asiatic cholera spreading, that idea. We can look at global health discourses themselves outside the law and outside of government.
So I think this approach is useful because it takes us beyond the kind of scientific neutralism of evidence-based medicine, just accepting, you know, this is how it is, and these are the public health problems, this is what we need to do. It's a kind of strong instrumentalist approach,
and a universalist approach driven by human rights, which I see in Gostin's work. I say again, I'm being boring, the national matters, the local matters. And that would suggest, of course, in terms of its interdisciplinary approaches, that as lawyers, if most of us are lawyers, we should take seriously what people like people are doing in anthropology and cultural studies. I may be telling you really basic stuff, but because the anthropologist will be stereotypically on the ground, she will be in the laboratory, she will be in the community, the cultural studies person from those countries or those regions will be able to tell you a lot about resonances, and patterns and so on. And that's where I'll leave it. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, John. We certainly have time for some questions, some discussion. Who would like to lead off? Ago, please. Maybe we can introduce ourselves too before our questions.
I'm Ago Mooney. I'm a bioethicist and I work at the Mason Institute. Thank you very much. There was a lot of food for thought and some really interesting, I think, illustrations to think about. What I found interesting, and you can correct me if I'm wrong about this, is this parallel that once upon a time we had the discourse of imperialism and these people that needed to be civilized and developed and so on. And the borders were broken because we had an empire, right? And this was the justification was that these people need to be civilized. We want to go in there and civilize them. And I find it quite interesting that in your talk, there's also, the borders are not broken by the empire because we don't have the empire, but it's broken through global health because infectious diseases do not know borders. Terrorism does not know boundaries. So now what we have is not, you know, the people that need to be civilized. What we have is these breeding grounds for infectious diseases and terrorism and so on. And so, you know, I was just wondering what you think might be the role of power in these chronotopes and what is left unsaid. So in the rhetoric, we'll talk about the local, we'll talk about nationalism and so on and so forth, but what we won't talk about is how we're going to maintain power through the IMF, through all these other routes that we're going to use, through giving a little bit of money for development and so on and so forth. And I was just wondering whether that's something that you explore in your in your model of chronotopes.
Thank you. Sure. It's up to you. Would you like to respond or should we ask more questions and then go through?
I'll respond. Thank you, because it's a great question, really. I focused on the rhetoric. My list talks about technologies and resources, and in a sense, if you're talking about naked power, coercion, military power, bribery, they come under those headings, it's true, and maybe a function of the rhetoric is to kind of disguise and conceal that, although I wouldn't simply look at the rhetoric in negative, false consciousness terms. I think it's productive, and he's got to aim in this particular case at US audiences and make a positive, by which I simply mean affirmative, case for things. The question about breaking down borders. So empire presumes no borders, at least within the empire. That's true. And that's one end of the spectrum, or one end at one point in time. And then we have, in the current phase, as it were, global governance, global health, also jumping the borders, relativizing them is a better, more sophisticated way, I suppose. But certainly getting beyond, pushing beyond the Westphalian closed nation state, that's right. I would agree with that if that was your point in that. And that is a way of critiquing global governance, is to do what I'm trying to start to do, perhaps not very well, but to excavate resonances, to go back to Conrad or Livingston, and more focused way to the history of colonial public health, work by people like Warwick Anderson, for example, and find the echoes in it, without saying it's simply the same thing again, isn't it? Now, what you're getting in between those two phases is decolonization and national independence, which for India is 1947. For most of the African countries, it happens in the early, late 50s, early 60s, Kenya 63, 64, so on and so forth. And we have a period then until the late 70s where these countries are quite robust in asserting their national independence and in linking up with each other, the kind of non-aligned movement, the Bandung movement, and a pushback at the centre, at the UN. A pushback, for example, in drug patents, where the Indians took pharmaceuticals out of the, they got rid of product patents for medicines, making them much more accessible. And the trips. So at the end of that phase, I'm giving you a world history here in 2 minutes, which is terrible. But so the borders go up in a sense. They're pushed back down again by the wave of structural adjustment, world trade law in the 19, you know, growing from the 1980s that produces things like TRIPS, which a lot of us would be uncomfortable with, but which also produces the election monitors, no election monitors in the 70s, and which produces, you know, more affirmative, positive, I suppose, global health governance measures about the Gates Fund. I'm not sure how you'd see that, but I don't know if that...
I agree with most of it. I just think, you mentioned decolonization and it makes me think sort of when sort of Belgium leaves the Congo, it leaves the Congo, but except that it leaves a lot of, you know, established trade agreements and so on and so forth, that leaves the power in the hand of Belgium and so on and so forth. And this happens to a lot of the African countries.
Yeah.
And it seemed to me that the only way of reversing that is to do what India does, to become a power that's great enough to be able to come to the world stage and say, we're not going to listen to what do you have to say about patents, for example. And just,
yeah.
That's why I think the question of power for me in that rhetoric, whether it's obvious or less obvious, is quite interesting.
Yeah, thank you. And I don't want to kind of...
Yeah, sorry.
No, it's very good. I don't have power in the model. I suppose rhetoric is an indirect way of getting through the modes. Thank you.
So carrying on from that, I'm sort of trying to put the pieces together between intellectual property law and international economic law, in particular, and the WTO, and that model of power, in a sense, which sort of changes the focus of the power to a global stage, but you still have to have the, you know, the power or the level of, it's not even the level of development really, but you have to have a voice in that at that table in order to be able to interact at it.
Yeah.
But I'm trying to then put overlay onto that your concept of nodal governance and how the different elements of the international or the public international regime impact on both those things, the WTO and the global system in a sense. Not quite clear how nodal governance works in this scenario. So it's about persuasion, I take it, but is it that what you're saying is it's a diffuse form of governance in which everybody's trying to persuade everyone else, in which case I would in a sense agree with that, but then you have the power question, who's actually able to persuade.
Yeah. Thank you.
That's a good question. This is the rough map for this case.
Persuasion is one element. So nodal governance isn't only about persuasion. What I'm trying to say is persuasion is perhaps a neglected element, that people run off to power straight away and go, and that's appeal, that's kind of moral or political appeal from wherever you're standing. So when I talk about persuasion or rhetoric, I don't presume equality. Different nodes, these different nodes are equipped differently. What he says, resources, technologies, and mentalities are accumulated, are enhanced. The courts, the parliament, have a constitutional basis for what they do in a particular country. In a wealthy country, they will have significant resources. In a country where the rule of law is being generally followed, then court orders, just to take that one, tend to be followed. Whereas the Kenyan courts, they're not bad about following them. I mean the government, for example. And in other jurisdictions, perhaps not at all. So different modes are equipped differently, and so their capacity to enroll other modes is quite different. The capacity of pharmaceutical manufacturers to enroll the US trade representative to enroll the World Trade Organization to allies, for example, is vastly greater than the capacity of Malawi to conduct a similar exercise vis-a-vis the World Trade Organization, and that is why troops reflected trade interests and not health interests and had to be corrected. So in a way the power here plays out in terms of how different nodes are equipped, and of course tradition, history, their position within a former colonial state or a currently dominant state endows particular nodes with greater resources, but also with greater cultural and rhetorical capital, if I can use that phrase. And I suppose a normative point that could be made on the basis of that, and Dreyfus and colleagues have made this point, it's not my idea, is that a fairer world system would seek to equip weaker nodes. Kenya, I suppose, non-governmental organizations with more resources, perhaps allow them to ally with each other. Or you probably know World Trade Organization history and law better than I do. But there was an element of international non-governmental organizations like Health Action International or Médecins Sans Frontières advising African governments as they went into trade negotiations in Geneva, so you're linking state and non-state, and trying to even it out. That's how I would account for power, I suppose.
I would agree. I mean, that seems to me, if you're not outside of a purely normative system, you're building in rhetorical elements, because in the public international arena, without a normative, without an enforcement mechanism other than the dispute settlement mechanism of the WTO, but in other arenas as well, public international law, without an enforcement mechanism, things that you're looking at, other types of power. But it's still really a negotiate. It's like a horizontal, primitive society, in the sense that is relying upon the imposition of other types of persuasion to enable people, well, to persuade people to act in a certain way, as if it were binding upon them.
Or leveraging, for example. Yeah, I agree with that. That's why I like their model. I think it's more adequate to the messy, the kind of spaghetti bowl of global governance. Okay.
Other questions? Yes, please.
I don't work on health, and I hope I have understood you. I'm just wondering whether you also look at the way these kind of global discourses are taken up at the national level. And I think legal anthropologists who study, say, transnational regimes talk about how they're translated or vernacularized and it's not, it may not be understood, like say, in the same way that Senator Luca is kind of constructing this problem, may not be the same way, and how, I don't know, it may be on the one hand instrumentalized at a national level to do certain things that the country wants to do, or it may be politicized, or I'm just interested in your
thank
thoughts.
You, yeah, that's very important. On this issue, as I said, I have neglected the Kenyan perspective here, I don't have interviews with the Cameroon people, which I have done in other areas, and following precisely that point that you're writing about perspectives and translation different ways. But I have come across, I have a picture of the director of Cameroon, and what he said around the time of the visit.